Passengers at a country railway station. To all intents and purposes, an everyday scene. But this country railway station in East Sussex is these days only used for pleasure. No bowler-hatted stockbrokers heading for the city. No tweed-clad farmers leaving for market day. No businessmen on their way to the industrial conurbations. 60 years ago, there would have been, because the local station was an important element in the life of the community, even if it was sometimes run by a man and his dog. When British Railways closed their rural route between Lewes and East Grinstead in Sussex, a small band of enthusiasts stepped in to save some of the line and to preserve the special atmosphere of the branch line railway, its rustic station seats, the wooden buildings, the enamel advertisements, luggage going in advance, and porters contemplating the next tea. Since the beginning of August 1960, the volunteers of the Bluebell Railway Preservation Society, working alongside a small group of full-time staff, have built up a collection of locomotives and rolling stock drawn largely from the railway companies which served the south of England, the South East and Chatham Railway, the London, Brighton and South Coast Railway, and the London and South Western Railway, who were all merged in 1923 to form the Southern Railway, who built this school's class engine, Stow, in 1934. Everything on the Bluebell Railway contributes to the vintage atmosphere, from the locomotives and carriages to the equipment in the signal box, which even has instruments that tell the signalman what the signals are doing. Everything is ready for the train to leave. But there's time for a quick one before we go. The locomotive pulling this train is Stepney, a diminutive tank engine built at Brighton in 1875. And this is the driver's eye view as she heads for Horsted Keynes. While the driver keeps a lookout, the fireman feeds the beast, topping up Stepney's glowing heart and creating the lifeblood that makes her move and which draws thousands of people to the Bluebell Railway every year. Steam. The foot of the first hill, less than a mile from Sheffield Park, and the fireman tries to satisfy Stepney's appetite for black gold as she starts the climb. It's quite a pull for an elderly Victorian. Once she's hauled her three coaches up out of the Ouse Valley, Stepney takes a breather and coasts downhill for a while, past the trees and fields which line the track. As the train drifts along, the driver closes the regulator, while the fireman tops up the boiler with water and shovels more coal onto the fire, ready for the final climb under the Three Arch Bridge towards the railway's northern terminus. Despite having had to work hard, Stepney is still all smiles as she arrives at Horsted Keynes, and her driver hands the staff, which is his permission to travel from one end of the line to the other, to the signalman. Horsted Keynes is a bigger station than Sheffield Park and was once a junction where trains left for East Grinstead, Lewes and Hayward's Heath. It's decorated in the green and cream colours of the Southern Railway, and it's here that most of the Bluebell's passenger and goods rolling stock is stored, including some luxurious Pullman coaches. While passengers wait for the next train back to Sheffield Park, there's time to pop into the elegant Victorian refreshment room, right next door to the bookshop, and sample one of the railway's most popular attractions, the refreshing pints of real ale, delivered in the traditional way through hand pumps. It certainly is. In the very early days of railways, most passengers were carried in open trucks, although this one's a bit more open than usual. But these days they have a roof over their heads and windows to keep the British climate at bay. It's here in the carriage shed at Horsted Keynes that the Bluebell's rolling stock is restored and maintained to a prize-winning standard. Not only the carriages, but the freight stock as well. One day, perhaps, this venerable London, Chatham and Dover Railway six-wheeler will be receiving this kind of attention. The carriage cleaning gang in action. Dusters rampant. Firing their loaded spray packs at the gleaming gloss finish of a 1930s carriage which the Southern Railway would have employed on its express passenger service. The thorough wash and brush up. It's just part of the Bluebell Railway's daily routine, and one which few visitors ever see. There would be no trains at all if there was no track on which they could run. And the permanent way is maintained by a mixture of full-time staff and volunteers like these. The signalman collects the staff as Stowe arrives from Sheffield Park at the head of a train of carriages built in the 1940s. And then she inches her way along the platform, besieged by photographers, anxious. did a more recent recruit to the railway's iron and steel army, a British Railways Class 4 tank engine, which made a long, slow journey from Devon to Sheffield Park in 1984, accompanied by a police escort. The low loader makes a stately progress along the A23 Brighton Road. The driver of the tractor unit has a splendid view of the road ahead, which is more than one can say for the stream of motorists queuing up behind. Perhaps the trickiest part of the whole operation is manoeuvring the engine into the station approach at Sheffield Park. The roadway falls quite steeply at this point, and great skill and finesse is needed by the low loader crew to prevent the engine being stranded on the tarmac. It's a tight squeeze, but she's nearing the end of her journey, and before you can say George Stevenson... In reality, it didn't happen quite that quickly. It takes more. Fairy with a magic wand and a cheery cry of abracadabra to bring a locomotive to life. 80064 was an operational engine, unlike others which had been rescued from scrapyards and brought to the Bluebell. But some preparatory work was needed before the fire could be lit, and steam gave her power so that she could join the other active engines and get on with the job of hauling trains. On a summer Sunday, there are usually three engines in steam, two to pull the trains and a third to look after the shunting. But once a year, yes, that is a young lady coupling those engines, once a year the Bluebell goes bananas and turns out every available engine to work the train. Sometimes they go it alone, and sometimes they do it in twos or even threes. Far from slumbering through the depths of winter, the arrival of December also brings the annual visit of Father Christmas to the Bluebell Railway, equipped with a sack full of presents and plentiful supplies of ho, ho, ho. Santa charms the children who come along with their parents to join in the festive fun on board the Santa Specials. While the children unwrap their gifts, Mum and Dad enjoy the trip, fortified by a seasonal snack. The engine chosen to deputize for Santa's reindeer and transport him and his happy passengers to Horsted Keynes is 541, the last survivor of a batch of freight locomotives built by the Southern Railway just before the Second World War. Soon, it will be January again, and the start of another 12 months of hard work for the Bluebell's volunteers and staff. From engine drivers to porters, from signalmen to plate layers, from carriage painters to civil engineers, they all have one objective: to recreate yesterday's railway scene on the famous Bluebell Railway in Sussex, where steam survives.
Be operated by steam, was laid to a gauge of 15 inches. The locomotives, however, were to be one-third full size. And on the 15-inch gauge, that's big. Opened for business in August 1926, although the whole of the new Romney Hythe route was not completed until the following year. In all, it cost Harry about £110,000, a fabulous sum in those days. With a staple diet of holidaymakers and the stringent 20s giving way to the 30s, the railway prospered. Harry had conceived his railway as a main line in miniature, and that's just how it's always been. The timetable is intensive, the trains run fast, and a high degree of operating expertise is required. The track of the Romney Hythe and Dymchurch runs roughly northeastwards from its principal base at New Romney via St Mary's Bay and Dymchurch to a terminus in the busy town of Hythe. It's about 8.5 miles, and the very first time you ride the train you realise what Captain Howe was getting at. It's a very level route, which enables the haulage of long and heavy trains, but the line has more than its share of level crossings. It runs parallel to the coast, and nearly all roads to the sea have to cross the track somewhere. The level crossings, once a source of danger in the days before flashing lights, are now merely an expensive addition to the operating costs. The principal stations on the line must be considered extravagant affairs by today's standards, but they, like everything else about the RH&D, are part of the original attention to detail that enabled Howe so successfully to create his main line atmosphere. Thank you. The quiet waters of the disused military canal herald our arrival at Hythe, the grand terminus of the railway. With no less than 4 platforms under the canopy, it's impressive by any standards. Behind the neat signal box, the second of the line's turntables and a small engine shed. Here the locomotive is turned and serviced in readiness for the 13-mile slog that will take it to the westernmost extremity of the line, Dungeness. The signalling was originally of the semaphore type, but the only examples to survive are here at Hythe, the remainder having been replaced by modern colour lights. Not even this railway is immune from the economies of modernisation. In fact, with the heavy burden of track renewal and a considerable full-time staff to support, Howie's little railway has been suffering all the same financial ills as its big brother. The locomotives were designed by Henry Greenley, and connoisseurs of these matters will tell you that they were the best he ever designed. Built by Davy Paxman of Colchester, most of them date from the original opening of the line nearly 50 years ago. The fleet consists of 5 Pacifics of the LNER type, all dating from the 1925 to 1927 period. 2 482s of the same vintage, the only 482s ever to run in Britain, incidentally, and 2 Canadian-type Pacifics built by the Yorkshire Engine Company in 1931. The only recent addition has been a further Pacific imported from Germany. Romney Hythe and Dymchurch Railway is a completely self-contained engineering unit. Its extensive workshops at New Romney are able to tackle everything from boiler repairs to the building of passenger coaches. Every driver has his own engine on which he either carries out or supervises all running repairs. It's an old-fashioned system, but one which produces the highest standards of mechanical turnout. One well-known Romney driver spent 19 years with the same engine. The section of line from New Romney to Dungeness sees much lighter traffic than the Hythe line, and a single track suffices. Gone are the meadows and dikes of the marsh proper, as the railway strikes out across a barren and beachy headland to bring it to a terminus hard by the lighthouse at Dungeness. The station here is situated on a large reverse loop, so that engines don't need to turn. The trains simply pass round the loop and head back towards New Romney. The rails on this section suffer particularly from their constant exposure to the salty sea air, and the whole problem of track renewal has now become pressing. There have certainly been recent speculations about the total closure of the railway, and although this seems unlikely, there's a real prospect of the double track section being reduced to a single track. That this would irreparably spoil Captain Howe's unique little railway is undeniable, but maybe it's preferable to some of the grimmer alternatives. Captain Howe died in 1963, and according to his last wish, his ashes were scattered here in the station yard of his beloved Romney. The line was taken over first by two bankers, and then by a public company. But since Howe's death, it has struggled from one financial crisis to another. Come to Romney and ride the train. That's the only way to ensure the survival of Captain Howe's little railway, the biggest little railway in the world.